أسئلة السادة الجلسة الثالثة يشارك فيها الدكتور كريك بويز ويرأس الجلسة الدكتور معتصم الغريالي.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. متحدثنا في هذه الجلسة هو البروفيسور أندرو هوسفال، وهو العميد المساعد لشؤون البرامج الدولية في كلية القانون جامعة سيراكيوز. محاضرته بعنوان Shifting Sands in Legal Education Perspectives from a New York Law School، ويعني يمكن تعريبه بأنه إطلالة على التحولات في بيئة التعليم القانوني. طبعاً العميد هوسفال ليس غريباً على جامعة اليمامة لكلية القانون بجامعة سيراكيوز، هي الشريك الأكاديمي لكلية القانون بالجامعة. وبروفيسور هوسفال حاصل على البكالوريوس ثم على دكتوراه القانون من جامعة سيراكيوز، وعضو بجمعية المحامين بولاية نيويورك وجمعية المحامين الأمريكية، ويشغل حالياً منصب مدير مكتب التعاون الدولي بالكلية، حيث يشرف على برامج الجامعة الدولية المختلفة، ويتركز اهتمامه البحثي على المسائل المتعلقة بالتعليم القانوني بصفة عامة، مع التركيز على جوانبه ذات الطابع الدولي وتأثيرها على الطلاب. فليتفضل مشكوراً.
Good morning. Thank you for having me today. My name is Andrew Horsfall. I'm the Dean of International Programs for Syracuse University's College of Law. And I must first say, merhaba. It's a true pleasure to be here today. My work in international education has spanned the better part of the last 10 years. And fortunately for me, it has not felt like work, which I think is very important. This is in large part because I've had the pleasure of working with international partners and colleagues like Dr. Ramadan and Dean Al-Hamoudi. Every year, I welcome international students to the College of Law, and every year, I travel to new countries to explore new opportunities for collaboration. In fact, I was remarking earlier to Dean Al-Hamoudi that this visit today marks my sixth visit to Saudi Arabia. It's the most visited destination for me among my travels to over 25 different countries in the last 10 years. And since my first visit in 2014, even now the kingdom feels both different, but I also very much feel and enjoy the warm embrace that I always remember when I visit Saudi Arabia. So shukran to all of you. Thank you for letting me share some thoughts with you on my own work in international education and on the value of legal, on the future of legal education. I'm grateful to Dr. Ramadan and especially to Dean Al-Hamoudi for the invitation to speak with you today. It is a humbling experience to offer my observations, ideas, perspectives, and predictions on the future of legal education before such a distinguished group of educators here in the audience. Many of you in this room are at the forefront of important legal reforms that will ensure the kingdom continues to thrive as a global economic leader. But in order to realize the kingdom's legal reforms, so too will legal education necessarily evolve. A forum such as this is an excellent way to explore many innovations that legal education professionals are considering in the United States and elsewhere. So I therefore like to share with you the perspective of just one New York law school that must reckon with a variety of new challenges: declining applications and enrollments, rising tuition costs, troubling national employment trends, new demands from employers, the rise of legal technologies, ever-shifting geopolitical concerns, travel bans, trade wars, tweets, and other issues of the day. So my goal is to offer, as we say, a 30,000-foot view of some of the challenges and opportunities that law school deans across the United States are facing right now, even at Syracuse University College of Law. I will focus on four of them. They are, first, the flat enrollment landscape for JD programs. Second, the expectation that employers, the expectation by employers that law schools will provide practice-ready graduates. Third, the need to adapt the law school curriculum to make it more relevant in the 21st century legal practice setting. And fourth, the combination of rising tuition costs and the need to train students for legal jobs that don't necessarily require a Juris Doctor degree. Let's start with the enrollment picture. Between 2010 and 2005, the US experienced a 41% decline in applications to more than 200 accredited law schools in the United States. According to the American Bar Association, which is the professional organization that accredits US law schools, in 2010, first-year law school enrollment across the US was over 52,000 students, but by 2019, that number dropped to 38,000 students. So that's a 27% decrease in law school enrollments. The trend of declining and now flat law school enrollment can be traced to the Great Recession, which began in 2008. And despite the fact that the US is now in its 128th month of the longest economic expansion in its history, fewer law graduates are being hired now than were being hired in 2007. So we expect in the United States that we will continue to see flat or declining US law school enrollments among American citizens and residents for the next decade. And if years of economic expansion can't drive enrollment growth, then it's hard to imagine what will. Furthermore, the US has also experienced declining undergraduate enrollments. They have fallen for 7 consecutive years, and in a few years, this trend will be exacerbated by a declining birth rate. This undergraduate decline will eventually roll into US law schools. So, if the US legal job market improves dramatically, there will simply be fewer college graduates available to pursue a legal education. And in order to thrive, US law schools must evolve to attract a different kind of student. One different kind of student is not the non-traditional student, but now the post-traditional student. This is a student between the ages of 17 and 21 years old, so this is not a young student. This is a post-traditional student who is not attending a traditional 4-year US college, so not in the traditional full-time bachelor's degree program. And this is also someone not living on a college campus. And today, at the undergraduate level, these post-traditional students make up an astonishing 85% of the total US college population. We're anticipating that it's the experience, drive, and focus of these post-traditional students which makes them ideal law school recruits. But residential law schools, where you are expected to live on campus or near campus and attend classes 5 days per week, are inconvenient for these post-traditional students in terms of location, time commitment, and cost. So the thriving US law school of the future must find and serve these post-traditional students where they are. And much like MBA programs across the United States, we at Syracuse have developed an online law degree program. Last January, Syracuse launched the first American Bar Association approved fully interactive online JD program. It's called the JD Interactive. The program combines a live interactive video, video conference class sessions, some self-paced learning online classes, plus in-person residencies in Syracuse and practical experience opportunity settings, which we call externships. So far, we have welcomed students from communities across the United States and the world, from Alaska, Arizona, Texas, Wisconsin, and other states. But our target student is not only the domestic student seeking an online forum to obtain a degree. I'm proud to say we have also expanded our footprint beyond the United States and launched what has become a very successful Master of Laws program for foreign-educated law students and lawyers. Recognizing the importance of shared experiences, cross-cultural competency, and the shrinking of our world across transactions, technologies, best practices, and other influences, the LLM program has changed the academic life of our college, particularly for our American JD students. What began with 2 students in the first year has grown steadily to nearly 40 students from over 20 countries each year. This exposure to otherness begins in school and extends in practice as students learn to collect a diversity of perspectives on projects, legal analysis, and problem-solving strategies. I'm also happy to say the success of this disruption in one area has set a pathway for another opportunity. And the momentum we have generated from the success of our LLM program has led to what will be the launch of our doctoral SJD program with plans to enroll our first cohort this fall 2020. And through this research degree, our students will spend their first year with us learning valuable research methods, practicing their oral presentation skills in a full year colloquium course, and working with faculty on research projects related to their chosen academic field, either in Syracuse or at partner institutions around the world. But let's now shift gears to our deliverable, what we're trying to create, which is a law graduate who's ready to practice in a firm, organization, or other professional setting soon after graduation. Law firms in the US tell us that they would love for law schools to turn out graduates who are the equivalent of third-year associate employees, but that is not something a law school can do, simply or well. The problem is that many law firms don't have time or bandwidth to train law students, at least not without help. Syracuse, like other law schools, have resisted the calls to do away with the third year of our JD program. And we've been thinking creatively about the third year and about practical training opportunities in collaboration with firms and organizations. We've expanded our practical training program into a semester-long 4-credit program under the supervision of a faculty member. And Syracuse's externship program began in 1977 with Law in London. It's another program that I helped direct, and which still provides students an opportunity to spend a summer gaining valuable experience in a dynamic international setting. Since the 1990s, our externship program has expanded to several cities within the United States and can now learn their trade alongside legal professionals in New York City, Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, Atlanta, San Francisco, and elsewhere. And as our online JD program, JD students continue to enter the program from locations around the world, our hope will be to expand the externship program internationally as well. Of course, the classroom is where students receive the traditional US legal education, learning black letter law, case law, and the Socratic method. But despite our technologically advanced law school buildings, Syracuse cannot reproduce the environment and culture of learning in a modern legal practice. So a few weeks ago, Syracuse announced a new program that merges our online and externship programs. We call it the Third Year Away. This program allows our third year students to complete their final year of law school with a combination of supervised externship and online courses. So Syracuse is not abolishing the third year of our JD program, but we're evolving it. And in collaboration with legal employers, we're producing a new generation of practice-aware young lawyers. And I think that's an important distinction, practice-aware. We want students to have exposure to practice, not necessarily so that they know everything, but that they know what to expect, they know what to ask, and they know how to learn in a professional setting. Syracuse University College of Law continues to adapt its curriculum to the realities of contemporary legal practice in other ways as well. This year, my college celebrates its 125th anniversary. So this milestone means that my colleagues have been spending time in our archives and libraries, unearthing historical documents and photos, making some interesting discoveries. One of these was a report card from 1903, the year our first African-American student, William Johnson, graduated. What was surprising is how little the law school curriculum changed since that time. But now it's the computer age. It's beyond the computer age, actually. And Syracuse's new model for legal education must make similar choices about what courses to make room for in our curriculum. For instance, courses in technology and the law will be absolutely essential. Already in the real world legal practice, artificial intelligence is being applied to the problem of flight risk and bail, while the spread of risk analysis and predictive analytics software means that arbitrations and settlements are on the rise. In law firms today, automated practice management and workflow systems are commonplace, and tasks such as billing and document mining are now being routinely performed with the assistance of intelligence software. Increasingly, large clients are selecting law firms for their technology-enhanced services and ability to deploy lawyer hours toward higher value work. So legal technologies will not totally replace the need for human critical thinking, judgment, and decision-making, but it is already helping lawyers and judges work smarter, more efficiently, and more accurately. Our judgment is often no better than our information, and data analytics and artificial intelligence have the potential to significantly increase the quality of information on which judgments are based. So what does the rise of legal technologies mean for legal education? At Syracuse, we're developing a number of new courses to prepare our students for 21st century practice. One such course, Technology and the Law, is a course that provides students with an understanding of the fundamentals of how technology intersects with law practice and affects the legal system and legal ethics. One conversation of the day among legal academics relates to the ethics around artificial intelligence, so whether you as a person are entitled to a decision made by a human or a computer, which is something that I think is quite interesting and we'll watch develop. Topics include social media and e-discovery, the admissibility of digital evidence, cybersecurity and privacy, artificial intelligence, big data and data mining, biometrics, facial recognition technology, autonomous vehicles, blockchain, and cryptocurrencies. Classes are taught by New York State practitioners who are already steeped in these fields. Which takes me to one of my last points. In order to thrive, it is imperative that law schools tap into growing employer demand for graduates and employees who are educated in the law, but who don't have a JD degree. That is, the US legal profession is moving toward a model that resembles the medical profession in our country. Legal professionals with JDs are still required at the top, just as in the medical profession requires doctors with medical degrees. But just as MDs are regularly helped by registered nurses and physicians' assistants, so too legal professionals increasingly are managing teams of well-trained non-JDs who perform basic legal functions, such as client intake, project management, and the management of legal technologies. So to capitalize on this trend, to offer new career pathways for young students interested in law careers, Syracuse has begun to explore a new Bachelor of Arts in Law degree. This new bachelor's level undergraduate degree will be an integrated learning major offered in conjunction with Syracuse's esteemed Public Affairs College, the Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs. The BA in Law could lead directly to work in a legal setting out of an undergraduate program, or it could be a stepping stone to a certificate of legal practice, giving the certificate holder advanced education and exposure to contracts, legal research, electronic discovery, etc. The bachelor's degree could also form the foundation to another innovation that US legal education is borrowing from MBA programs, the 3-3 program. A 3-3 program allows an undergraduate student to complete his or her bachelor's and law degrees in 6 years rather than the traditional 7. 3-3 programs therefore shorten the path to the undergraduate degree and a Juris Doctor, which is also a response to the rising costs of legal education. In closing, let me share with you the motto of our law school that Dean Boies, has coined for the College of Law. We will leverage our knowledge, skills, and imagination to expand legal education in innovative ways. Dean Boies and I have used our travels across the globe and in our meetings with esteemed colleagues to expand our own knowledge and imagination of what legal education can and should be in the 21st century. We have sometimes noticed that legal education programs of other countries often try to replicate the traditional systems of JD programs in the US. But my message today is that law schools like mine are themselves disrupting their traditional approach to legal education in order to better prepare students for a globalized 21st century practice. So today, as I have outlined, we are embracing online legal education, international programs and competencies, expanded practical training programs, innovative legal technology, and offering a mix of different graduate and undergraduate degrees and certificates. Legal practice and legal education are becoming increasingly globalized, and today we find ourselves exploring and also emulating the innovations we see in other countries. It's a global marketplace after all. So I want to thank you all for your time today. Thank you, Dr. Ramadan and Dean Al-Moody for having me. Thank you all.
أعتقد لدينا الوقت لسؤالين أو ثلاثة سريعين، فحنأخذ الأسئلة إن شاء الله، وبعدين دين هوسفال يجيب عليهم إن شاء الله. فلو حد عنده أسئلة، بس محتاجين سماعة.
Thank you for this very interesting talk. Just noticed that artificial intelligence and machine learning, have been evolving very fast during the past decade. The legal domain appears as one of the domains where AI and machine learning give outstanding results compared to humans. What impact this evolution will have on legal education, and are we going to see a kind of convergence between legal domain and IT domain? Thank you.
Yeah, okay. So that's a good question, and I think that's a question that law schools are exploring right now as they're developing and redeveloping curricula and courses around technology and the law. I think the focus is on working with employers and technology companies in the space using artificial technology to see what issues they're dealing with and how might their lawyers be helping them work to mitigate and reduce risk around the decisions they have to make, some of the challenges they might have in implementing artificial intelligence into their own existing business models, and it very much seems to be an evolving conversation between education and the industry right now.
أسئلة؟ هناك؟ في الشمال، على الشمال.
Thank you so much for this great presentation. I would like to take the chance to ask you from your own experience whether the quality of the graduates from the e-learning or the distance learning in your university has a minor quality from those normal students. Why I'm asking this question, I had a problem myself. I'm an old guy and I start studying lately and I got a degree with the e-learning. And then I made up the continuation. Then I found out that some people are not interested in this e thing, and they say the quality of the people is not that good. What do you think from your own experience?
Yep. That's, thank you for that question as well. To answer that question fully, I'd like to come back in about 3 years when our online graduates have taken the bar exam. But I'll tell you that in terms of quality, we see a few different points in the life cycle of the student to help drive quality. One of those is at the admission stage. So we are admitting applicants to our online JD program who are at or above the 75th percentile in terms of quantitative metrics for admissions. So looking at higher GPAs at their undergraduate level and higher LSAT scores in terms of the required admissions test that we have in the JD program. So since launching the program 12 months ago, most of our online graduates, most of our online students have completed 4 or 5 of their courses. All of those are at the first lower division required sort of traditional doctrinal classes and contracts towards property. It is our own professors who are also, who teach those subjects to our residential students who are also teaching those to the online students so that the content is the same. We have experienced professors teaching that content and our hope and what we're seeing in terms of the exams and the grades is that the return on that teaching meets the expectations and the satisfaction of the professors who teach both residential students in a classroom as well as online. But it is a developing program, and that's a very, it's a developing question because those graduates have not completed the degree. It takes about 5 years. And so that is something we also are very interested in watching. We feel confident in the product, the education program that we're delivering to students. The American Bar Association, which granted us a waiver or a variance of the rules to offer this more fully integrated, interactive program, is also curious about this question. And so what they have done for us is provided a cap. So while they're allowing us to offer this online program, we are only able to enroll 65 students per year into the program. So I think on all sides, we're all cautiously optimistic with good intentions to see how this works and what will work. But so far, so good. And I'd love to come back and give you some good news and positive results in a couple of years as well.
You mentioned that the decrease of number of students enrolled in the School of Law in 2008 mm-hmm. was due to the world recession. So some analysts are forecasting another recession in the next couple of years or so. What are the strategies that you have obtained to avoid the decrease of number of students again?
Yeah. Another good question. I mean, it remains to be seen when another recession will hit. I think there's an expectation that there is a bubble somewhere that may pop. We, in US legal education, didn't really feel the effects of the 2008 recession until about 2 years later. So whether or how long a delay of enrollment into law school in the next recession is a question that we're trying to understand. I think to answer your question about what we're doing, the online option, offering an online, more flexible degree is one of those ways that we hope to be a bit more accessible to students. Being able to pursue the and spread out a JD program over 5 years, allowing them to stay in their communities and continue working in their current jobs on a part-time or full-time basis is also something that can help them financially as well. And it's something we're looking at, but it's a question mark for the future.
سؤال أخير.
Can the that you are developing your student to and being practitioners and working in legal industry. And my question is, this is conflict with academic skills, or do you face any conflict with how developing your their academic skills and research and also mm-hmm. developing their practical skills.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so with the three-year traditional JD program, the students are spending most of their time in those first 2 years reading, writing, and doing a lot of research. But at the same time, the industry is changing faster than education can really keep up, faster than deans and faculty can adjust and evolve their curriculum. And so knowing that, we feel we have to put our students, or at least provide opportunities and push those students into experiential learning settings like externships, like practice. We have to. They need to be ready for the world. It will be different for them coming out than it was when they went in. And so it is important to have the research skills. I'll say that Syracuse is one of a few. There are a couple, not every law school, but we require 3 semesters of required legal writing and research. So there's an additional 3rd semester of legal writing that's required for our students. We know that's important, but we also know that being exposed to and observing and experiencing the professional world of lawyers is also significantly important for their future career success as well.
شكراً ضيفنا الكريم وأخيراً ندعو سعادة الدكتور حسام رمضان رئيس الجامعة لتكريم ضيفنا العميد أندرو هورسفولد.